Hello, welcome to Tight Lines. The main theme of the show this week's carp fishing. And I guess the best description I can give of my guest here in the bothy is that he's a carp angler's carp angler. Gareth Fareham is one of those specialists who goes for quality over quantity and likes nothing better than a difficult, classic English carp, preferably scaly and dark, hiding away in a massive weedy pit somewhere. That takes some finding, never mind catching. And we're finding out how Gareth goes about his sport over the next hour. Also coming up on today's show, we get out on the bank with fellow carper Joe Jagger, who demonstrates his Zigrig methods, superb way to search the layers and find exactly where the fish are at this time of year. There's also some quality roach action with specialist angler Duncan Charman, who employs a twin feeder approach to great effect on a session at the Royal Berkshire Fishery. I'll have my weekly fishery focus too, with useful information for all types of anglers on the sport to be found, most effective tactics to use, and the conditions in store around the UK. Well, thanks for finding the time to come to the bothy, Gareth. I know you're a very, very busy man.
I've got a lot of stuff that keeps me out of trouble, let's say.
Keeps you off the bank as well, unfortunately.
Yeah, unfortunately, yeah.
But we saw that you're a teacher there, but that doesn't mean a carp teacher, you're actually a school teacher.
Yeah, I'm a school teacher, yeah. I teach at a comprehensive 11 to 18 in Sherborne. Yeah, teach art to secondary school kids, yeah.
What
it's great.
A lovely part of the world as well.
It's lovely, yeah.
Sport for all kinds of fishing around there, aren't
Yeah, not so much good carp fishing, actually, in that area so much. I live in Bournemouth, so it's a bit of a commute, but I'm closer to my fishing in Bournemouth, which isn't so bad.
You must go past a bit on the way to work.
Yeah, I do, past Bramford and up through Stour and up through the Stour. Yeah.
And you're catching a few, and I mentioned that you like dark, old, scaly English fish, and it doesn't look that old, that one, but it's certainly dark and scaly.
It is an old one.
Is it?
I would imagine, I don't know the exact age of it, but it's got to be in the region of sort of 30 plus years up. I mean, it's certainly an amazing example of a really nice, classically proportioned English carp. It's really lovely fish, yeah.
That very contemporary special. Fish, you had that recently?
Yeah, about 3 weeks ago now, I think, maybe. Yeah, certainly, by a long shot, the biggest January carp that I've ever caught.
Is it really?
And how
have you found this winter? Has it been different from normal winters?
Yeah, I mean, I must admit, for the last probably 3 or 4 years, since moving to Bournemouth, really, and having the rivers on my doorstep, I've kind of kept the winters for my river fishing, because generally I'm so into my carp fishing through the spring, summer and autumn, the rest of the fishing gets neglected. So I think because the big carp fishing is so hard these days in the winter, it's nice just to do something different for a change, fish the rivers for chub, and it's right on my doorstep, so I'd be mad not to, really.
Fantastic.
But obviously because of the floods this winter.
Especially the Stour.
Stour has just been a complete write-off since before Christmas, so I had everything ready to go, but I just concentrated on the carp fishing, really, which was, you know, quite fortuitous, as it turned out.
Now, a crucial aspect of carp fishing during the winter months is to establish exactly where the fish are in the water layers, especially when it's been as unsettled as it has been this year. Joe Jagger demonstrates just how effective the Zigrig approach is on a session at Drayton Reservoir, one of Northamptonshire's.
I've got three rods out in open water here. I've got them quite spread out, so I'm covering a vast expanse of water, and I've got two different tactics on those rods, just so I can see what the fish are going for at this time of year. Just going to talk you through some of those tactics now. Even in the winter months, one of my favourite tactics to use on highly stocked venues like this is a zig rig. That means fishing off the bottom, mainly in the upper layers of the water. Now that might seem a little strange to some people, but the fish spend a lot more time in the upper layers than people give them credit for. Today, I'm using a zig bug. This is an imitation louse zig bug. It's a black one. Black's my favourite colour for zigs. And it's on a light mono hook link. I'm fishing this about 2 foot under the surface. Now I've got that on two rods. And what I'm going to do throughout the day is I'm going to move the depths down, up and down, to try and find what level the fish are feeding at. On my third and final rod, I'm using a solid PVA bag. I don't want to give the fish too much food, so there's a bit of pellet in there, there's my hook bait and a few small boilies. And to this, I'm going to add some liquid attractant. I'll just pop the syringe in there. Just put that in so that when the bag dissolves, that'll disperse through the water and hopefully draw the fish in. Right, I'm going to have a move now. I've been in this swim for a couple of hours and there just doesn't seem to be any fish activity out there. I think if the fish were in front of us on a water as well stocked as Drayton, we would be catching, and we'd be catching quite a few. the wind isn't doing us any favours. So I'm going to go up that far end there where, and just fish on the back of the wind. It's slightly shallower, so hopefully the water temperatures will be a bit higher and we might get amongst a few fish. Right, I've stuck to my zigs on two rods out here. I've got a PVA bag on the third rod again, but I've just shallowed the depth of my zigs because it's a little bit shallower out here. And when I'm using zigs on highly stocked waters like this, I like to create a bit of attraction. I'm doing this with a Spod Cloud ground bait and a few different variations of pellets mixed in. And it mixed it up so it's really sloppy. And what that does, when I've spotted it out, it creates a massive cloud of attraction with very little food content. So hopefully the fish are going to come in charging around like piranhas looking for food. And the only real food content to them will be my zig baits. So hopefully they'll pick them up straight away. As you can see, it's really, really sloppy. So I've taped the holes up on my spod just to stop it coming out. I'll probably put about 10 of these out and then see if anything happens. If anything hasn't happened in about half an hour, I'll put some more out and then top it up every fish, presuming we get a fish. Yeah, we've got one. Right, as you can see, I'm bent into a fish now. We've moved a couple of hundred yards down the bank to a bit of shallow water. Just feels that little bit warmer. And at this time of year, them couple of degrees more warmth can really make a difference. And we've had action pretty much straight away. It's on a zig rig that's fished about 4 foot off the bottom in about 7 foot of water. So we're at about mid depth there. Certainly putting up a good fight. This time of year, when the water's really cold, the fish can really shoal up together, especially on high stock waters like this. So it's really important to find them. And then hopefully once you've found them, you'll catch plenty more. There she is in the net. And here she is. It's only about mid double figure, but what spectacular condition it's in. Certainly put up a good fight, didn't it? I'm more than happy with this fish on a freezing cold day like today. Right, let's get this fish back and then let's get amongst some more, hopefully. That water is absolutely freezing. Right, I've just slit that fish back. I'm just going to talk you through some of the baits I use for zig fishing. As you saw this morning, I started off with this little louse imitation zig bug. Now that's normally my favourite, but it just wasn't happening. And I felt that I sort of wanted to provoke a response from the fish, sort of like a frenzy. So I changed to this one. This is actually a new bait. It's called a critter. And it's just black and yellow with a little bit of fleck of colour there. And that's hair rigged to a size 10 Fang X hook. And that's what got me the response straight away. Now, throughout the day, if I wasn't catching, I would tend to change around. I've carried loads of different bugs with me, sort of like a fly angler would. As you can see, if you're just looking here, I've got loads of different colour ones. So throughout the day, I will be chopping and changing just to try and see what the carp are favouring. Right, we're losing the light now. Somehow the conditions are managing to get even worse. The gates are going to be closing soon and I've got a 4-hour drive back home up north. I'm very happy with the fish I've had today because the conditions have just been totally against us. Hopefully by watching this you can see that zigs will work 365 days of the year and hopefully you can put that into your own angling and catch some fish.
We were just talking there, watching that, the best laid plans and everything for zig rig fishing, I think, is like match anglers, bread punch fishing. It wants to be calm, frosty, probably clear. What do you think?
High pressure, yeah, absolutely. Mm. That's when I keep my zig rig fishing for. I must admit, I've always been, especially on the bigger lakes, I've always been a little bit concerned about the amount of undertow that's going on, certainly on windy days, and how your zig is actually going to sit. Is it going to sit dead, or is it going to be kind of wandering around? I mean, that might not be a bad thing, but I think also casting big, long 6, 7, 8 foot rigs out on windy days is kind of never the one. But I think that's the kind of conditions where they're going to be down on the bottom feeding. I think calm, clear, blue skies, high pressure. When it's tough,
get them out.
I think, yeah.
No feed.
3/4 depth for me, I'll start at.
And we can talk about that in the next part, because I've got a little theory, you'll hear it soon as well. Welcome back. Carp angler Gareth Fareham is my guest in the body today. And we saw Joe there just before the break talking about his zig rig fishing. Mm. And I've got this 8-foot depth theory. I think fish are really comfortable 8 foot below the surface, or at least using 8 foot as a median line. If it's high pressure, there might be a bit above that. Yep. Low pressure, there might be. Have you got any theories on that?
Like I said before, I've always gone for the kind of 3/4 depth. Starting point, and then worked up and down from there. But equally so, I think I've often thought it's, you know, very, very weather and condition dependent, you know, kind of warm spring, summer days, up above 3/4 depth. And just from observation as well, you know, spending a lot of time up trees, watching them as well. And I've seen as well with zigs, I've watched them up trees, approaching zigs and being kind of slightly under or slightly below. And it has to be within a certain window.
Really?
Otherwise, they'll just miss it. Yeah, which is one of the reasons I always think zigs are quite a difficult tactic to get to work on the lower stocked lakes, because there's so much less chance of them being in exactly the right window.
One per 2 acres going past at the right. Yeah, that is. Yeah, is it? Yeah. Whereas on the bottom, it's just like matchings, but bait on the bottom. That's where they've got to go to eat.
I think it's something to do with the field of vision. I think if they're a foot or two below or above, I just think they often just miss it. Yeah. I think it has to be within a certain kind of sphere, from what I've seen from observation anyway.
And that's where watercraft comes into play.
Yeah.
Now, Joe was obviously quite keen on the bugs, but you've brought your little zig bait box in here, and there's an interesting mixture. There's some, and I'll try and pick out some various colours. There's a bit of just ordinary high-density foam in black.
That's great, isn't it? Because it's so buoyant, isn't it, as well? It's
exactly.
Great. And you know, it's really tough. You know, it's never going to come off.
And it'll take a little bit of flavour as well, won't it?
Just give it a little squeeze. Soaks up the flavour really well. You can smell, obviously, they're all flavoured.
And the reason why I'm holding them is they smell very nice.
Yeah.
I might not touch quite so many of those things over there in the body. But the smell does stay in here. We have to open the windows when you've gone to let it out.
I've got to be honest, I don't really think the smell makes any odds for a zig. At all, personally. I think it's purely on site, really, I think, personally. Mm. But hard to make a call.
Well, again, I've got another theory about flavours. I think they might disguise our smell rather than enhance the smell of what you're using.
I'd
rather something smell like that than smell of sweat.
Yes. Oh, yeah. I'd agree.
But these are...
They're all fairly traditional kind of zig baits. Must admit, I'm a little bit slow on the uptake with kind of newfangled ideas and things. And, I mean, I remember hearing 4 or 5 years ago, some lads were taking their carp hooks to fly tyres and actually getting them to make what I suppose were the predecessor of the current kind of zig bug type trend. But I've always done, you know, really well just on the foam or on a cork ball. Has always kind of done well enough for me. But
and cork doesn't absorb any flavour, and of course it just has a bit on the outside.
Yeah, it's just a visual thing.
We always love a bit of live bait in the studio, and you've brought in some maggots with PVA bags already tied up with maggots in. These are, you've said, probably your number one winter bait.
Yeah, from probably December through to about kind of mid-February, through that real tough time when the fish can become a bit dormant, you know, they're not really eating a lot, they're not really doing much of anything. I just don't think you can beat maggots, you know. You'll catch a few, obviously, on the single hook baits and things, but I just think there's so much more that you
the
can be doing.
The wriggle factor.
Yeah, it's just, you know, and also, you know, you can bait regularly, almost like you're drip feeding, you know, fishing a river or you're trotting or something. So I might put, you know, a spom or two out every couple of hours, something like that. They sink very slowly if you've got fish in the area. But I mean, the biggest thing really is that you can get some other feeding activity going.
Yeah.
So I've caught an absolute rake of tench this winter before I caught the one sort of big carp, and I'm 100% convinced it was all that feeding activity going on.
You've got some partially prepared rig here. Just now, that's that sort of a standard pop-up with a buoyant bit of corn on. Just show us how you put your maggots on that.
So I must admit, I think a lot of people, when they go in maggots, because they're a small, delicate bait, I think they often kind of like to fish a great big bunch of them. I personally like to fish a really kind of small, sort of delicate presentation. But because I do want to still fish a fairly big hook, I like to keep them balanced. So hence the buoyant corn. So what I do, I only fish three maggots on the little ring that's tied on. So just thread the three on, try as best as I can.
Just a micro ring tied under, so the corn, the hair goes through the corn, then a micro ring.
That's it, yeah. So you've just got the tiny, tiny little micro ring on top.
It is one you've already done. Look,
it is a little bit fiddly, but I've got to be honest, I 100% think it's worth the effort. I try my best not to burst them. You just get a bit more life out of them. And again, I think the fact that they're alive.
Well, you did this probably half an hour ago, and they're still alive. And I'll tell you what, there's a massive difference between, in big game fishing terms, those baits would be described as bridled rather than hooked. And there is no doubt that bridling baits, be that maggot or a live blue runner, actually keeps the baits in much better condition than sticking some hook. You're a brave man doing that. That's a fiddly old job, and you've done a great job of doing that.
So I basically just tie like a two-tone grinner and then just tighten it down gently onto the maggots, because what you don't want to do is kind of split and burst them off. So you have to kind of keep them on that small little ring. And then you basically just tie a couple of overhands to put them on to the hook.
Now, I've evacuated the goldfish again. Can we see how that works?
Just part of the.
Sorry, I put it down there.
That's all right.
There you go.
Part of the beauty of this rig. If you just fish maggots on the deck with no extra bit of buoyancy in there, they have a tendency to kind of crawl around on the bottom, and your rig might sit funny. They can kind of actually tangle your rig. Yeah. And I've always, for years, I've really believed that your rig needs to be sitting perfectly all the time, especially if you've got tench activity, you've got stuff going. So your rig's getting moved around, but that buoyancy is always just going to help reset the presentation. So if we...
Would you fish that naked like that? You've got these bags tied up. Would you put a bag on it?
Yep, I would just hook on a little bag.
That's good one. Let's see how it works. We've got...
You're going to get quite a lot of maggots out of there, actually.
That's all right. So I can dry them out afterwards. Yeah, just show us how you put that on. I know it's a bit iffy because that's gone a bit...
It's probably going to... I would just literally hook it through, so... You do have to be careful not to burst them. But again, it's one of those things. I think a lot of people are put off with the maggot fishing because it's quite fiddly. And then I would just put a little bit of PVA around there just to stop the hair tangling, because obviously that's quite a longish.
Let's drop that
longish
hair. While we're discussing other things, we can watch that break down.
Just drop down.
There you go. Yeah, it's interesting with these. I saw somebody posted something on a bit of social media yesterday saying that was perfect. Look at that. They just had a fish. Lost a fish because their PVA bag hadn't burst in time, and they tied it with oily pellets. And they'd done it on the bank, so it wasn't like they'd had it tied for 2 or 3 weeks.
Yep.
But they said within 2 minutes they had a one toner and lost the fish. When they went in, the bag was still
there. Still some PVA. I mean, you see some people maybe hook it through the knot or something like that, and I just try and just kind of nick it through. And then nick it through again, so you've almost gone through two bits. Because that bag was tied a little while ago, they tighten up after a while, so I couldn't nick it through twice like I normally would.
But when you look at that presentation,
there's still a little bit of PVA on there.
But there's not enough there to hinder the hooking of a fish.
And obviously,
just
what you've
perfect
got,
perfect presentation.
You've obviously got the corn is sitting those up above the top, and you know, so A, you've got something that is going to keep it kind of tangle free because it's up above the bottom. But also you've got the extra little bit of colour there.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, that's what they're going to pick out first.
I mean, I know you've put some stuff in the maggots as well. We can talk about that a bit later, because I want to do this question. Rob sent in a question.
Yeah.
He says, is it possible to over-flavour hook baits, pop-ups or bottom baits? And you've got a variety here, some of which seem to be deeper in flavour. I mean, those, for example, there's a lot of... A lot of gluggy type liquid in those.
Yeah.
Can you see that there? Look, there's lots of liquid in there. Mm. That's not too bad.
No, I think that's the key thing. I think absolutely, yes, you can overflavour pop-ups. Yeah, I think so. So I tend to go with two approaches, basically. Through the summer, I'd either use a fish oil, something like salmon oil. Pure salmon oil is great in the summer. It's fantastic, and you can't overdo that. You can put, you know, you can literally leave them soaking in that all summer, and that's great. Or kind of one of the kind of thick, heavy sort of amino-based liquids as well, like the bulk food liquids. They're absolutely great as well. With regards to sort of the bright single hook baits, I think
these ain't over bright, these are they?
They're not too bright. I fish a lot, almost all the lakes I fish are gin clear, absolutely crystal kind of tap clear. I've often been a little bit wary of the really bright fluoro colours. I prefer ones that are still bright, but just not kind of too leery. I think sometimes the older wary carp can just be a little bit
Very interesting, that very subtle pink colour, which is the lighter tone of your shirt, I might add. But that sort of colour in over 3 metres of water is probably going to be a very pale monochrome, but it will still stick out against gravel or silt or weed or whatever.
That's the key thing. Yeah. And I think also, more than anything, if you're fishing, because I'll still fish the bright ones over bait. If I've got a couple of kilos of fish meal out there, I'll still put a bright one over the top of it. And all it has to be, really, in my mind, is different to all your bait. That's the one that'll home in on.
That's me fishing double maggot on hook over a bed of casters, mate. It, trust me, it works. And as far as stillwater sport for course anglers, on more match-based commercial fisheries, the roaches we saw Duncan Charman there are back on song. And some great perch catches too, with lots of fish over £3 from venues where they don't usually get caught, don't usually get targeted anyway. It's that time of year, and with maggots taking over from pellets as bait of choice, it's always likely to tempt a big old stripey. With pressure rising, carp anglers will be turned into the trusty zigrigs, as we saw earlier, with either yellow and black foam or the more exotic buoyant bugs, as Joe Jagger had, as the lure. Remember the 8-foot rule. I've always found fish are very comfortable at that depth, but err on the shallow side when atmospheric pressure is high. And we've mentioned zigrigs, we've mentioned the maggots. What about as far as bait goes? Are you still using a fair bit of bait this winter?
No, not really. None, actually.
None?
No, either maggots or singles for me. And to be honest, even through really up until... I think the fish are so mobile. Once the carp wake up, they're so mobile. The best way to catch them, I think, in the spring is on singles. Fishing mobile, following them around. You know, they'll be one end of the lake one day and they'll be the other end the next day because they're moving with the weather and the sun and the wind and everything else. So I just think the best way to catch them is on a single, really, this time of year.
Like property, just three important things. Location, location and location. And there's... you brought a couple of pictures in. Now, that is obviously a winter fish and that's a corker. Is that from one of your local pits?
No, it's from one of the Yateley Lakes at Sandhurst. Yeah, often used to go there for a couple of trips in the winter when times were sort of really tough.
And it's always a good place. Sandhurst.
Yeah, yeah, and it's great because it's quite shallow, so they often tend to feed through the winter. And the maggots were great winter bait on there. As a rule, you couldn't get a bite on anything else through December, January, February.
Really?
Yeah.
And now, but we've got this to look forward to. Spring's on the way. And that looks to be, with the nettles behind you, that looks a bit of a springtime fish.
It was about mid-May, I think, that one.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. It's from one of the really lovely pits around Chichester Way. Some really beautiful fish there.
And when it comes to May time, are you putting a bit of bait in then? When do you start putting the stuff in? Or are you not a great user of bait?
No, I do. Probably sort of from about mid-May onwards, I kind of start to think about putting some bait in, really. But, I mean, it all depends, really, when they spawn, how they're behaving. And I just try to... I don't really have any fixed plans ever with my fishing. I just kind
of
just tend to go with the flow, just try and respond to what's happening. I think that's... it's one of the keys with fishing, isn't it, really?
Yeah, I'm absolutely sure you're right. And they definitely like a bit of snap once they've had a spawn, don't they?
Oh, for sure.
Get them on the proteins then and they're
absolutely.
Rabbit. And I've got to say, I read everything I'm sent. And the publisher sent me a copy of your journal, which is a weighty tome. It's like a telephone directory, isn't it?
It's quite big, yeah.
But I've got to say, without blowing too much smoke, it was a great read and some fantastic images. It's not a magazine.
No.
And it's not a book.
No.
Why is it?
There's so many fishing publications out there now, and there's also a lot of books out there as well. So I wanted to produce something that was kind of clearly differentiated from either, basically. Not a book, clearly not a magazine. It's a yearly project.
I noticed it's issue one.
Yeah, so I'm working on the second one at the moment. That should be due out again October, November this year. So the plan is to bring one out each year. Each one have a slightly different theme. I'm going to have guest editors as well. Oh, yeah. So Simon Hartop is working with me on the next one, which is really exciting. He's bringing a lovely kind of old school twist to it and some different lakes, different writers, different feel.
I like Simon's bit in this with my mate John Gard talking about the tidal Thames, which is the end of my road. How unlucky am I?
Yeah, that's terrible. Yeah,
it's nice that so many books and so many magazines and some books as well try and reinvent the wheel.
Mm.
And I love stories. I love reading. And you've got some foreign authors in here as well, European authors, and reading about how everything is different but remains the same. It intrigued me, I've got to say.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's one of the things I look for when I'm kind of looking to piece these things together and looking for authors and potential writers. Just people that kind of have a similar way of thinking about their fishing, interested in similar things. All the guys take a great photo as well. It's a very visual publication.
Yeah, absolutely.
Lots of big spreads of pictures. And I think they're the two things for me that fishing does really well. Great stories and great imagery. So
fantastic.
Yeah.
We love it. That's about it for today. I'll be announcing our Young Angler of the Month competition winners for February in next week's show. So, reminder, send us your photos on an email, please, together with some information about you, as much as you can, and your catch, and a bit of consent from your parents, too. You'll find all the terms and conditions on our website, alongside loads of other great stuff, and you can follow us on Twitter as well. It's been great chatting to you, Gareth. Thanks so much for coming in, mate. I've really enjoyed it.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
Now, with the river course fishing season nearing its end, next Friday I'll be joined by specialist Keith Spear, an angler with the knack of catching good fish, no matter what the conditions. He's certainly done better than most of the rest of us this winter. We're on at 6:30 on Sky Sports 2. That's next week's show with river specialist Keith Spear, 6:30 p.m. Sky Sports. Don't forget, we're also available on demand every week in the Sky Sports section of Catch Up, alongside past episodes and a few specials as well. But it's goodbye for now. Have a great week wherever you're fishing, and tight lines. Thanks, mate. Cheers. Lovely stuff.
Thank you.
Oh, perfect.
Watch all 6 Sky Sports channels on your mobile and online.